Hello and welcome from Copenhagen, Denmark. I'm Lucas Alexander, reporting for Age of Truth TV. And I'm here with Dr. Rauni-Leena Luukanen-Kilde, who is in Denmark to be part of a presentation of the film, the Age of Truth film, The Grande Dame of Consciousness, which premieres tonight in front of a live audience. Thank you very much, Dr. Rauni, for coming to Denmark, and welcome to our country.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Thank you. First of all, just to get the record straight, so that everybody knows what you've done in your life, please explain to us what your work has been. You've been the Chief Medical Officer for Finland, but you've also done a lot of other things. Please tell us what exactly you've done.
Well, that's a long story, but I'm a medical doctor with three specialities, and medically, I have been Chief Medical Officer of Lapland, the northern part of Finland, or an area of 100,000 square kilometers, which is bigger than Benelux countries together. But I have also been Director of Environmental Health and Health Education of Finland at the National Institute of Health. And in that capacity, I was replacing the Chief Medical Officer of Finland when he was traveling. So I have a solid background, also privately. My father had a very prominent business position in Finland, and I've been married to, actually twice, but both were military, a Finnish major and a Norwegian major who was a UN diplomat in Geneva. Then I'm also an international bestseller author in six languages on parapsychology, ufology and mind control.
Yes, you've really written a lot of books that's been quite successful over
the years.
With some really mind-blowing info, obviously. I mean, it's
you
started writing about these things and talking about these things at a time where people just didn't talk about it. How do you see the difference between when you started writing and talking publicly about this and now in 2013?
Oh, that's a great difference. There's a great difference because I've been going to international conferences for almost 40 years and dealing with these topics in the States, in Europe, in Russia, all over, and giving interviews to Japan, etc. And it seemed that in Scandinavia especially, I think people are less informed. Or should I say maybe, especially the male population is afraid to deal with paranormal phenomena, because that breaks their worldview. It breaks the view what it is to be a human being on this planet.
But isn't it the males that usually do truth researching and really go into researching about conspiracy and things like that?
Oh, definitely. Absolutely. They have been the forerunners and women come after. But I think the world is going to change upside down. The women are going to take over and the males are sort of watching what we're going to do.
But that's not really a very good balance, is it?
No, we should have the balance, of course. But, you know, before the balance comes, it goes like this and then it's hopefully stays there.
But don't you think that the women are the women's liberation, which happened already in the late 60s and has been happening all, and now there's a lot of women on top positions. Yeah. But don't you think a lot of it's kind of been a little bit imbalanced. It's not been a very good balance because women have taken the position of the male role and become quite masculine, and men have become a little bit not really not knowing where to be, either the really successful businessman or the homeless guy or the criminal or whatever.
Absolutely, but we need that balance, like you said. And women have to come forward, and women will. We go out to the world and not being at home so much as previous generations. And on the other hand, the male are coming more to take care of the family, also in home. That is that females become more masculine and males become more feminine.
But do you think that's the nature of human beings? I mean, the males are usually the masculine type and the women are the more feminine type who's taking care of the children.
That's right, but that is only the body. And what is a human being? It's not the body. Man is a mind, not a body. And when you think of that, you realize that the core of us is an energy body and it is a light body. And it is two things. It's like a driver in a car. Our body is the car, but we are the driver and not vice versa. So to start, you have to think that every single cell vibrates. Every single cell, not only the brain cells, like old-fashioned doctors may think. I was at Oslo University and listening to a lecture of Noam Chomsky, a very famous American professor, retired, known all over the world, and he was saying when the brain dies, there's nothing left. And I opposed immediately. I said, look, I mean, for over 30 years there have been evidence of out-of-body experiences, near-death experiences, and that shows that you can get out of your body with your energy body. And of course, Americans and Russians use it for espionage and space travel. But that at least shows that it is a reality because NASA, never a straight answer, that's what they say about NASA. So anyway, it has two departments which are incredible, one for telepathy and one for getting out of the body. I find that out, found it out about 30 years ago when they tried to recruit me, but I'm not for sale.
So NASA tried to recruit you?
That's right, through somebody, mm-hmm. of course. And I was supposed to take contact with the military attaché in the American embassy. Interesting, so it is a military thing to get out of your body. But I said, no, thank you.
But you have actually done some research in underground facilities, underground bases in America.
I have been reading, I have met people who have been there. And it's interesting that they also scan on your eyes so that when you go in, you can, you know, your ID card can be changed, like, you know, falsified. But you can't falsify the retina of your eyes. So therefore, they scan you from your eyes before you are allowed to enter.
But that also, nowadays, in 2013, that actually happens when you go to the airport and they check you.
Oh yeah, they scan the body. And of course, TSA has been doing it, and it is, I would say it's criminal, because they're radiating the human body. And even those who are working in TSA as staff has started to get cancer. So think what it does to a human body who has to travel all the time and is being beamed and beamed.
So there's a lot of radiation there.
Exactly, and now they have changed. Now they're saying that at the biggest airports in the United States, they have to shut the TSA machinery down because they have seen that there's evidence that it causes cancer. But on the other hand, that is part of the depopulation program. I think it's pretty terrible that from 1992 already, in the Rio conference, the Earth Summit conference, they decided a UN Agenda 21 that the world population has to be diminished by 85%. Think, 85%. Now,
don't you think that's just speculation?
Oh, no, that's absolutely true. And they have different agendas how to do it. And it cannot be speculation, because I just read that Oklahoma, the state of Oklahoma, House of Representatives, has decided just March 2013, that they will abolish, they will not follow the UN Agenda 21. I mean, so, you know, when a state makes that kind of decision, they try to protect their own people. And of course, more states are going to follow. But Bill Gates, for instance, who is the greatest maybe supporter of this plan in the whole planet, is doing it with vaccines.
But who initiated this plan?
That I don't know, but I would guess that so-called Illuminati, the people who behind the scenes govern, give orders to Mr. Obama or any prime minister in the world, because that is the agenda, UN agenda. Who initiates? Well, the people who were there. One of them was the Prime Minister of Norway of 15 years, Gro Harlem Brundtland, the lady who later became a WHO's Director General for 5 years and is retired now. So it's a group of people who steer the world in a way.
But do you think that the Illuminati really exists? I mean, people have talked about them for years, and it's almost been like been put into movies, and it's been like romanticized a little bit, like a sci-fi kind of movie. Do you think it's just something they just put in the media and out there for people to be fascinated by, but it's not really the truth?
No. We can call them Illuminati. The name means nothing, actually. But there is a group of people who steer this planet. And they are multimillionaires, often Zionists. That doesn't mean that they're Jewish, all of them. You can be a Zionist, you know, for Israel without being a Jew. But they own the mass media in general. They own the money. They really steer the world. And if you don't obey what they say, something happens, like to Kennedy brothers, like to Anna Lindh in Sweden. She was the foreign minister who was killed by a mind control patsy. But do
we have some kind of proof that Anna Lindh was killed in that way?
Well, the proof is absolutely there because of the behavior of the Yugoslavian young man who did it. He said he was hearing voices. And that is what they are doing. Now, normal people think, and some doctors even, old-fashioned, which generally the doctors know nothing about these fields. But anyway, we have no education in it, none. You have to find out yourself if you want to
know.
But
you're a doctor, and
yes, but I didn't get it in my education. No doctor gets any, not one word. Not of parapsychology, not of mind control, not on our contacts with cosmos. Not a word. But he was hearing her voices giving him orders. The same happened with them in Norway with Anders Breivik, because he was also hearing voices. And that is...
Was that something he stated? Was it something
yes,
he said?
Yes, he heard, yeah. And the thing is that they educate, quote, young men as criminals, I would say, as serial killers. And it is done in different ways. That's mind control. And that is that you start hearing voices and they microchip you without your knowledge. That can be done.
What is a microchip?
A microchip is a very, very tiny chip that is put into your ear, through the nostrils, into your eye, or any part of your body. And it's so small, you can get it with a handshake. It's so small that it's 2 micromilli.
How would you be able to get it from a handshake?
Yes, if I had it and I would say hello to you, there's nothing you can do, you're chipped. But also, you're chipped if you took the swine flu influenza vaccine, because there was a microchip. It's a global plan. So, and that's Bill Gates again.
Well, a couple of years ago, the whole swine flu epidemic was raging and everybody was talking about it. It was all over the news and the media. Everybody talked about how dangerous the swine flu
was. That was just hoax, because swine flu as an illness is much, much milder than any normal influenza.
Are you serious?
Yes, I'm serious. Medically, it's much milder. So the so-called influenza flu that we get every year, that is much stronger than the swine flu. But they made it upside down again, that, you have to take the injection because otherwise...
The vaccine.
The vaccine. Otherwise, you're going to get it and, it's going to destroy you and you're going to die and whatever. I mean, it was a hoax propaganda throughout the world.
But a lot of people took that vaccine.
Exactly. Huh? And a lot of people who were pregnant, like in Canada, they lost their babies. And at least I know of 70 cases. And so Canada withdrew the vaccine away, 170 doses, because they knew that it was the vaccine that caused the abortions. Now in Finland, it's known, and in Scandinavia, that it caused narcolepsy in children. And in Finland now, they have been reimbursed, because you have to go to court and it is absolutely sure that this vaccine was toxic.
But doctors, so many doctors all over the world talked about this and said that this was very important to get the vaccine.
Because they're either bought by the big pharma or they're ignorant. And I would say that majority is ignorant.
Yeah, because they don't, most people really believe, obviously, if you're a doctor, you want to help and whatever.
That's right. But there are two things when you get vaccinations. They're the contents of the vaccine. You give that to the field, to doctors and to nurses who are giving vaccinations. And then the other one is for the researchers and insiders, and they're totally two different things. I mean, if you would read, if a nurse or a doctor in the field would read the researchers' contents, they would say, oh, never, never, ever. I mean, the contents is pretty bad. It's not only the adjuvants, you know, starting from mercury and all kinds of preservatives like formalin or whatever, but they have even fetal cells, aborted fetal cells. They have had urine, they have had kidneys, they have had blood of different animals, etc. When you read that list, my hair stood up. I mean, really, nobody would have taken it if the people would know, but they don't.
But I mean, even doctors who are as highly educated as you were, they have studied these things.
No, we do not study what, for instance, generally the doctors do not know the contents of vaccines, generally, those in the field. But when they do read it, and especially when you see on television or radio somewhere, there's a doctor saying, oh, I took this vaccine. Then you know, hey, that's red alert. Don't believe him. Because either he's paid to do that or he's ignorant. But usually they're paid. Or when they take a vaccine, that vaccine is not containing the bad things, ingredients. It is pure. Like Angela Merkel took one and said, oh, she took it. Yeah, but she did not have the same content as people in the field. Now, the football gang was it Italy? Yeah, they refused. Also, military in Germany refused. Now, why? Hey, why? If it's so bad, you would want to save the soldiers, etc. They knew somebody gave a warning.
They did not take it.
They did not take it. So that already shows that there's something fishy about the whole thing, and it is for depopulation. It's official. It's official that it's for depopulation. Katrina Fitz, whatever her name was, Katharina Fitz or Austin Fitz, who was advisor for the government of USA, said clearly, already. Well, it was 2009 that the swine flu vaccine is for depopulation. The same said Bill Gates in a TED conference in the United States, 18th of February 2010. The vaccines are for depopulation,
and so they said it publicly.
Yeah,
for people to hear, the population.
Well,
to hear
it's
it.
Bill Gates' video is the internet, so anybody can hear it.
So why doesn't people know about this?
Because they don't click. They don't. They're not interested, and they can't believe that your own government is accepting. The health authorities are accepting.
And your own
to destroy
doctors.
You. Exactly. But it's only money and power that counts.
But how about vaccines in general then? I mean, we talked about the swine flu vaccine, which you are not a big fan of, and you are saying that is really for depopulation.
Yeah.
But vaccines in general for things, when you go to the doctor and you get prescription drugs or something.
They have in the States about, was it 22 or 24 vaccines before you're 2 years old. Now, think of it. Who needs over 20 vaccinations before you're 2 years old? I mean, what kind of pandemics we have? We don't in the Western world have them unless the military laboratories spread it.
But what about baby vaccines like for measles and whatever,
exactly.
All these?
They can be just as dangerous. See, in the old days, 50 years ago, vaccines were to help. Today, the ingredients are totally different. Remember, vaccinations are for depopulation. And Bill Gates said in this video, which I saw myself about this conference, that It's only three kinds of people that we want to leave for planet Earth, and that is the elite, that is technicians, and slaves. Slaves, they call the general population as sheep or cows, that's slaves. And that is about 10% of world population. The rest can go.
Because they think there's not enough resources for everybody?
Exactly, they think so, but I don't think it's true. This is their excuse, because it has also been said that that if we take all the population of planet Earth and put them in Australia, they can stand there and there's still room. Of course, it's not as easy as that, but still. So
really?
This is an agenda to get rid of people. And I just read...
Is it because they think that being too many on the planet is dangerous?
It's resources they're thinking. I just read the comment from Dr. Anderson, and I happen to know, I don't know if he's alive, he's over 80 if he is, that he had a ranch in Wyoming, and a Bilderberger, of course, but Bilderbergers are not number one. It is the Council on Foreign Relations. Bilderbergers are a front, you know.
Please tell us what the Bilderberg group, right?
It was founded in 1954, and the name came from the hotel where they were having a meeting, and they were gathering VIPs from different countries, even royalty, and Holland was, you know, initiator, and from all over the world. I mean, it's the mass media moguls, it is the top politicians, it is top industry, and they gather about once a year, and then they hear what are their plans for the future. I mean, I heard that Kissinger had said years and years and years ago that China is going to be number one country in the world. And now the general public who sort of follows things can see that that's absolutely true. But they have planned it that way. So it's just a group of VIPs who gets orders, because they don't decide, they get orders. And then they go to the respective countries, like our prime minister at that time, Paavo Lipponen, came back to Finland from a Bilderberger meeting, and he said, and it happened to be in Denmark, so he said that, oh, we have to put up the oil prices. That was the order. I mean, why would the prime minister go in a private meeting and say, we have to, as a country, put up the oil prices? Because that was the order, and everything is
from
about
the Bilderberg
money and oil.
Group, yeah. Or Bilderberg right, group meeting?
Yeah, that's where he came from.
So how much power do they actually have? It seems a lot of truth researchers are talking about the Bilderberg Group as being the one controlling everything and making decisions about what the next year is going to be.
I don't think they control and make decisions. They decide, and they're being told these are their plans, like Kissinger says about China. So they don't decide, but they get the information. And the ones that are really controlling, they're also part of them in Bilderberger groups, but that is just the front for the world. The real actors are behind, like in Council of Foreign Relations or Trilateral Commission. They're much, much more important, but you don't talk
really?
About... Oh, absolutely, the Council of Foreign Relations especially.
What is the Council of Foreign Relations really, if you want to explain that
well,
to
it's,
people?
Well, I would say it's a group of people who at least govern the USA. And the most important, of course, you have to have a position to be there, because then when something is being decided, then you can go and say, okay, I'm in this position and now I give orders. You know, like swine flu or whatever. Gardasil is another
Wait,
bad...
Wait, what?
Gardasil, the vaccination that they are now promoting to prevent teenage girls' cervical cancer. Come on, teenage girls do not have cervical cancer. It's a disease for 50-year-old women. But now they also say that it is for males. Come on, males don't have a uterus, as far as I know. But anyway, now they have changed it because it came out that, you know, why this promotion to prevent the cancer of the uterus and the tip of it. And then they said, oh, this is a viral, so a virus can hit men too. You know, they change every time, you know, somebody criticizes and they see, now people are getting up to it. So I would say don't to everybody, don't let your children have a Gardasil injection. In the States, it's one every 5 years. In Finland, one only. Why is it so different? The same vaccine. The testing, and in America, the first year, 2010, I think it was, there were over 20,000 who had very bad side effects. That is, brain, the effects, and about 100 died the first year.
Really?
After the injection. And in Texas, I read that the governor had given orders that it is compulsory for the 12-year-old girls, to take it. Because he had, according to the information I got, he had shares in the Merck factory, the drug firm. Then he has denied it. And then one has said, no, they don't need compulsory vaccination. I mean, but Bill Gates says it right off. And it's known for those who follow. But how many follow?
But why is Bill Gates, who's a computer, he's a multimillionaire, but he's a computer man. Why is he talking about vaccinations and medicine? Is he a doctor?
No, but he is one of the promoters of depopulation. And when you can kill people with vaccines, when you can kill people with chemical trails from airplanes, and he says, they're going to put things that, your body absorbs, your skin absorbs, your sweat takes them. Well, what can you do? You have to breathe anyway. You can't say, even if there's a chemtrail, that I stop breathing. So that is for depopulation. They think they're saving the world from all handicapped people, all people who are blind or deaf or have other
handicaps. So there can be no malfunctions.
Exactly. It's a Nazi type of thinking. Nazis took away everybody who was a little bit deviant, all sexual deviants and the elderly. And if you're 70, like Kissinger has said, that they are unuseful eaters or something like that. So,
Kissinger, isn't he over 90?
He's 88 or 89 now, but he said it already 20 years ago. So, if you're according
when
to
he
these,
was 70.
If you're 70, out. Now, I mean, this is ridiculous, because again I come to the thing that what it is to be a human being. A human being is not the handicapped body, and besides, we have all chosen the bodies. That is our energy body, which is in eternal, because Einstein says that, said that energy only changes form, it doesn't disappear.
But
so we are energy.
Many people lack proof of what you're saying, that we are only an energy body, that it's something, it's not as, provable and as something you can see. It's not as material as what is happening in the world or vaccines or the political or financial system.
Well, let's put it this way. Getting out of your body is a military question, number one. It's military, because they use it for espionage, okay? Military secrets are not delivered normally to the general public.
And nobody knows.
So, right. But those who have had out-of-body experiences themselves, because they've been in a car accident, or they've been operated, and during the operation, they may leave their body. That happened to me. It really did, because I was in an operation, of course, under narcosis. And all of a sudden, my energy body left, and I was a young doctor. It was incredible, because I was floating exactly as a copy of my physical body. Exactly as a copy, but it looked like skim milk, and it was floating towards the ceiling. And I was looking down, and good Lord, I saw the surgeon who had opened my stomach and was operating on me. And I thought, oh good Lord, I'd never seen myself like that before, of course.
That's not a pretty sight either, is it?
No, but I was a doctor, so I wasn't shocked in that way. But when he took the scalpel, the surgeon, to cut, I tried to, in my astral body, in my energy body, I tried to prevent him. Hey, don't do that, because I have an abnormal anatomy. And if you do that, you're going to cut an artery. But of course he couldn't hear me, of course he couldn't see me. So he cut, and all I saw is blood
But you didn't
feel anything.
Straight
to the ceiling. No, the energy didn't, because he was operating on the physical body and not the energy body, of course. The blood went to the ceiling. And then I had a near-death experience. All of a sudden, felt like I went to a tunnel and there was light.
And so it can also happen through a spiritual meditation.
Absolutely.
Right, leaving the body. A lot of people who are into the spiritual and healing and clairvoyance talk about that. It can happen through meditation. Is that something you know
of
about?
Course. Yeah, it's the same thing. You get out in different ways. But I went out through the, you know, through the operation. And what happened was very interesting. It changed my life totally. Because all of a sudden I saw there was a sea of white pearls. I mean, it was just an experience. And then I saw a black pearl way, way behind. And I couldn't understand. And a being of light came in front of me. And it was so bright that I had to kneel. And it looked like, well, I'm a Lutheran by you know, birth, so it looked like Jesus' figure. And it said, because the black pearl, I said, what is that? It's your husband. And I was told, we're going to get a divorce because he's too far behind. Not because he was bad, but we were on different frequencies. Okay, and then this light being, looking like Jesus, you know, like Statue of Liberty was so big, and I couldn't look because it was so strong. He said, it's nothing, you know, great to be a doctor. And I was a young doctor, I was proud of it. And then it showed my whole life what's going to happen. And I couldn't understand, of course. And then I came back to the body and I wake up. And then I start to say, I have seen this. Oh yeah, yeah, you know, you lost so much blood. It's okay.
But if you saw Jesus, I mean, a lot of people who would see Jesus would think of it as like a revelation and a proof that he exists, and this is a religious proof, isn't it? Was that how you felt at the time?
No, I just felt the light. But if I had been a Muslim, according to research in near-death experiences, I would have seen probably Muhammad. If I had been a Buddhist, I would have seen Buddha. So it depends on your cultural background, how you experience when you're in other dimensions.
So it's about what you've been told.
Yeah,
life
what
is,
you have learned in school,
what your upbringing has
exactly.
been like, what you've been brought up as a Christian, Muslim, Jew, Buddhist, Hindu.
Yeah, that's right.
And then you see those gods, but isn't that too obvious?
Oh, I don't know. I didn't know what I was going to experience. But in general, you can say if you're atheist, that comes from research too, you just see the light, a being of light. And what does the being of light number one tell you? It says, what have you done with your life? What have you done with your life? And your life from your birth into this body to the moment that you're out because of a whatever accident or what. So everything you have said, everything you have experienced, just goes like a film, like this.
A lot of people have said that
exactly.
when they kind of
what
been
have
death.
You done with your life?
Mm-hmm.
And then you see where you've done wrong and were thought wrong, and hey, there, that was not good, and this was good, and you sort of you're corrected in a way. You want to make good, and then you sometimes get a chance to will you be on the other side, or will you come back to Earth, to your body? And generally, people don't want to come back to the body because this is not a very elevated planet. There are a lot of people who are very, very ignorant here, and we're aggressive, and we don't use our brain capacity. Normally, we don't use 90% of our brain capacity. So most people experience they don't want to go back because it is harmonious, it's beautiful surroundings, and the other frequency where you are, but
what,
you have
what
to.
What is known as heaven? I mean, in
well,
religious
you can, yeah,
terms.
Well, yeah, we can say it's heaven. Yeah.
But how about hell? That's the counterpoint.
There are experiences that are negative, about 1%, and the people who experience very much negativity, they are within meeting people who are like them, negative. But they can call it hell if you want. I mean, there is no hell. It's all in your mind, of course. But when they come back, they usually change. They see that I don't want to go to another frequency which is so negative. So your own thoughts, your own expectations, they decide how you experience the other dimensions. And then you have a chance to correct all the mistakes.
How many dimensions do you think there is?
I can't say, but in CERN, in Geneva, they talk about 9 when I was living in Geneva. In at the end of 80s, they talked about 9 dimensions, but at that time also in 1991 I was in Moscow UFO conference, and there the scientists said that Russians know 21 dimensions, but of course they are unlimited.
21 dimensions.
Yeah, that's what they said. I have no
proof. What's happening in those dimensions, do you know? Have you heard about that?
I don't know, but things are totally different, of course.
But we're in the third dimension here because
we
see everything with three-dimensional eyes, and it's the knowledge through our five senses what we decode.
That's right. And they also say that the fourth dimension is time. I mean, for us, there's time here, right? I mean, what time is it? But in the universe, there's no time. They sort of count according to big happenings in the world. I mean, if you have a huge earthquake or storm that kills thousands of people or something, so that is, you know, not noted. But it's not noted in the clockwise like we do.
A lot of people talk about we are now entering the fifth dimension. What is the fifth dimension? Is there any truth in that, you think?
Well, at least it is above the third, and of course it is different. But what happens? Again,
what
it depends
on
you.
Exactly.
I can't
explain it. Well, compared to the third that we're in.
Well, at least we don't have the physical body. We are in an astral body, in an energy body, that's for sure. And then there, your thoughts may direct you.
Is everything.
That's right.
So we don't have connection with another energy being, something that is not
physical?
Oh,
everybody who's on your level. It's like if you're in school, and we are all in school of life, but if you're in high school, you have contact with all your schoolmates. So those people who are in that dimension, of course they have contact.
They can communicate.
Of course.
Yeah, but can they see each other?
Just like you and me. I mean, it's another world. It's just switching to another world. It's like switching from CNN to Sky Channel. And everything happens on Sky Channel, but we who are here, and we don't have that antenna, or we can't put the, you know, press the button, we say, oh, there's no Sky Channel. Of course it's there. And people who say that, oh, there are no other dimensions, what kind of proof do you have, etc. There's absolute proof, but it is hidden from the general public because it changes everything. It changes
because
everything.
Because you think it's too difficult for people to understand?
Depends on your background. Some scientists are very skeptical, and it's interesting, the skeptics cannot go to the other dimensions because they close, you know, it's like they have closed the door. You have to open the door, you have to be open, you have to accept that, you know, we are not the biggest ones in the universe, unfortunately. And I just read about this Russian general who has come out now and said that they have 200 scientists working on what it is to be a human being, making a strong superhuman. And they decided, they had three different categories. They were scientists who were working on trying to get tuning into cosmic contacts. They were military, and there was a group of women. And of course, I would say of course, but males may object, but this is true, it's a fact. The women were the best.
Why do you think that is?
Because women are not so prejudiced. Women are, many times they open up and they're more
into the spiritual, emotional world, you think?
And they are not so closed, and they're not afraid to tell what they have experienced. Males are very afraid to, you know, to say that, hey, I was in another dimension, I met ETs and I met my dead grandmother. A big
business
man.
Because other men might...
Exactly. It is so important for males that what other males think of them. It is not so important for women. But in this experiment, they said the women were able to tune in. And they did go to a dimension where they went to a real spaceship. And they were talking with the humanoids, extraterrestrials, who said that they don't want to give any information to the military, but they gave them instructions how to build a machine for healing, for, you know, to cure illnesses. And then they said, the human beings on planet Earth are like children to us. I mean, they're dangerous children because they don't understand. We don't understand, you know, what we're doing. So we have to be supervised in a way that we wouldn't destroy everything. And then they said, and that, of course, hurts, especially males, especially scientists, I would say, that they said that they are not actually interested in communicating with us because we are on such low level. And you can imagine that people who have, you know, gotten Nobel Prizes or whatever, they don't accept that we are on a low level. But since we don't use about 90% of brain capacity, we are on a low level.
When you say that they went there and they communicated, they talked to the to the extraterrestrials,
just like
how
you
do they talk?
I would think that they talk. He didn't say that, the general, but I would think, because he said they were able to tune in. So I would think it's telepathic. But whatever, they were able to communicate.
I mean, otherwise the extraterrestrials would have to learn Russian, wouldn't they?
Oh, but they can. they can, you know, through telepathy, they can tune into you. Mm. So they can speak any language, even Finnish, which most people can't. So it's incredible world that we are going into slowly. And of course, the big brother who steers the world here, I mean, human beings, they don't want people to know, because they would lose, absolutely they will lose their power, their money, and that's why it's easy to say, oh, we want to get rid of 85%.
So this Russian experiment, this Russian...
it's not just experiments, it's ongoing, 200 scientists all the time.
And this was actually reported in the mainstream media?
That's right. And when he was asked, why does he give this information? At the same time, when White House said there's no proof for White House that there is any contacts with extraterrestrials in the universe, nor on planet Earth. So, well,
why do you think Russia is giving out this information when the United States is keeping it a secret?
I think that the answer is what President Putin said. He said, if USA is not going to give information about our cosmic contacts, Russia will. And I saw myself a video just a month ago in Finland with a Russian interview of Mr. Prime Minister Medvedev. And it was in Russian, but it was with Finnish subtitles. And he said, when you become a president of Russia, you get two attaché cases. And the other one is for the code of atom bombs or whatever, if there's a war. But the other one is about extraterrestrial presence on planet Earth. I mean, Prime Minister says this a month ago. I mean, when you say that, oh, there's no proof or whatever. Hey, those guys...
So he has a briefcase with like...
Yeah, exactly.
With like X-Files inside? Real X-Files?
Real X-Files. The president, when you become as a new president of Russia, you get that information. And it's about the same time when White House denies everything. Now, Russia and USA have always been competing, right? So maybe there's something... Russians are very spiritual. The people on you know, in Russia. There's a lot you can criticize about the administration, like you can criticize the US administration, going to war for oil and whatever, minerals all the time.
But the Russian population are also very suppressed and have been through
that's changing.
Communist regime.
Oh, yeah, that was terrible. Everything was suppressed and everything was scientific and they were afraid and whatever. But I was in Moscow in 1990s at a UFO conference in the beginning, and that information that was given there was flabbergasting, because they were scientists at the national the Soviet Academy of Sciences. It was Soviet time, and there were pilots. There were the Soviet Navy's chief of intelligence was the chairman of the conference, and it was open to everybody. And the person who opened the conference was a cosmonaut and General Pavel Popovich. And I had met his wife in a conference in Germany a few years ago. And she was also there now as an audience. So I said, oh, Marina Popovich, well, that's nice. So I sent I had a very special calling card made in blue and gold letters made in Geneva. So I sent it to her, you know, she was in first row and I was on third. I said, hey, would you send that to me, to her? And she took it and realized, and she turned around and, you know, and sent me a caramel, you know, sweet, like, hey, I know you. And then we talked and we made a deal that tomorrow we'll have lunch together. She never came. She never came. Why? I'm sure KGB interfered. She never came. Well, you know, you are not allowed to talk, because then when you talk, you get information. Which was sad, but she was a fantastic lady and still is, I'm sure. And now there's more information coming out from Russia.
Well, in your book, this is the Danish version of a book called Hidden Worlds.
It's a Norwegian version. Maybe
yeah.
It comes out in
It's actually Denmark. Written the same way
is
in
it?
Danish. Yes.
Really?
And Hidden Worlds is the English version of it, and that is your latest book.
That's right.
You talk a lot about the UFO experiences and a lot about these extraterrestrial otherworldly phenomena.
Yeah.
But I mean, do we have some solid proof about these extraterrestrial beings? Because a lot of people are filming UFOs in the sky, mm-hmm. and they talk about it, and you know, there's a lot of things, but most people do not see it. And even if they see it, they're not sure about this. I mean, do you think it's some kind of sci-fi fantasy, because people are watching a lot of these, like the X-Files or mm-hmm. Star Wars and all of that? Do you think, how
it's
much
not
proof
fantasy.
Do we have?
Oh, we have enough, but it's military. It's military proof. Every country's military has the proof, and they're not allowed to talk. Of course not.
But you saw a UFO, you're talking about that in your book.
But I'm not military, I'm a civilian. And it's not only that I've seen UFOs. I've been taken up, but I forgot it until I was hypnotized. And then the whole scenario opened. And I've had 9 car accidents, believe it or not. Somebody wants to get rid of me. And the last one was so bad that I would have probably left for good this body. But there came, believe it or not, when I opened up my eyes after being 20 minutes unconscious in a crushed car, all of a sudden I look and there's a little entity, no hair, no teeth, giving prana healing to me and my body. And I just, you know, just out of...
What did it look like?
It was about 1 meter high and no hair around.
Well, an interdimensional being or extraterrestrial?
Well,
or?
I don't know which. But I would think that it was extraterrestrial. And I knew that it's helping me. In fact, it saved my life, because I didn't know I was bleeding so badly inside that I would have probably died.
Call those gray aliens? That
well, in a way, it looked a little bit like it. But it was very positive. And in America, they say grays are bad and, you know, they're raping you and whatever. No, this being saved my life. Because then when I went to the hospital, of course, the doctor did all the mistakes you can do. I mean, did not even take a skull x-ray, and that's pretty bad. But that, again, later I understood why he did it, because there has been a connection in a previous so-called life.
Well, something must be watching over you, huh?
That's right. In Sue, we had a new system for the water, drinking water, and I drank 2 glasses. And the mouth just, I thought, oh good Lord, what is this? The cat drank, started vomiting. I took it to a water laboratory. It was full of heavy metals and arsenic. They tried to get rid of me.
Because you're giving out all
exactly.
of this information and because of your background?
Because both.
Because of a solid background?
Because I give the information and I've told them there's no death. So I don't care what you do to me, because I can't die. Of course I can get out of my body. And they saved me, and they saved me, and they saved me. Somebody put the chimney, a thick plastic with ropes, and I always put the fire on. Of course, the smoke would have come and maybe, you know, destroyed me, at least all the beautiful things I have at home.
But it must take a lot of bravery and guts on your part to stand there very much alone, I would expect, and talk about all of these things. How do you cope with the reactions of people who are listening to you and talking to you? Because I'm sure that the general population, you give lectures all over the world and in your books and talks and interviews, and I would expect that a lot of people would have a problem with that and maybe even ridiculing you. How do you feel about that?
Ridicule, of course, is done by intelligence agencies.
I mean, but even normal
people can do that, but I don't care because I know what I know. It's like, you know, if you have had a dream and you tell me that you had a dream and I said, oh, you did not have that dream, I don't believe you. So what do you care? You know that you had it and the other one doesn't.
A lot of people are very concerned with what their friends and other people think.
No, I don't
have that fear.
No, of course not. And number one is I have no fear of death. And that is the biggest fear in the planet Earth. Because people don't know that you can't die. Your energy body cannot die. Your thoughts, your intelligence, your love, your hates, whatever, that is in the energy body. It's not in the physical body. You just get out, like the car crashes, the driver gets out, takes another car, other maybe model, other color, which means next time maybe you're not a white male, female, something. Besides, in the energy body, they don't have sexual organs. Which is really something mind-blowing, because all of us are actually neutral or androgyne, because you don't have the sexual organs in the light body. And that also explains, in a way, homosexuality and transsexuality. You know, there are people that are born into a male body, and they feel that they are female, and they even go and have an operation. We have over 100 operations in Finland every year. The state pays for them. And I was at a conference where the member parliament of Nepal was giving a lecture, and he said, in Nepal, we have officially three sexes, males, females, and those who are both or none. I mean, you know, and it's in their passport. And I just laughed and I said, try to come to Norway and see how the reaction is, you know, when you have this. It's official. It's the High Court of Nepal and the parliament who have accepted it.
But it's about reproduction and sexual desire, isn't it? Well, male and female.
Yeah, right. But that's part of the body. And of course we have to have them because we need next generation. But the next generation, it's possible that we are not... In the next few years, well, at least in 100 years, we don't exist anymore as a human race, because the radiation, which is all around the world now, and which is done deliberately to suppress our reproduction, okay, but with animal studies, they have noticed that it takes only 3 generations and then it's finished. So
really?
maybe 3 generations of humans. And we are finished because it is irreversible.
Do you think anybody would really do that?
Oh yeah, the elite does.
Why?
Because they say we are too many on this planet.
But everybody dies from radiation. They can't.
They have their own means. They have, like, the military has their own means to fight against mind control. But normal people don't. It's very, very sad that. Number one, the general public knows nothing about this. And like I said, intelligent agencies always ridicule. I just read in a Finnish, the biggest newspaper in all of Scandinavia, northern countries, a professor of physics and an academy professor said that there's absolutely not one research which shows that mobile phones are dangerous or even the power stations are dangerous. I mean, come on, I have a very good booklet, you know, this called Det du ikke vet, What You Don't Know. And it is in Norwegian, and it shows what mobile phones do when you have. This is a 5-year-old child, this is a 10-year-old child, this is an adult. So you can absolutely prove that it's very much more dangerous to children than it is for adults. But even for adults, there research for 12 laboratories in 7 countries in Europe. It was a European Union research, 2004, showed that mobiles cause, for instance, brain tumors, under the level which is acceptable.
But how could we all live without a mobile today? How is it possible? Everybody uses it for depopulation. But it's very easy and very convenient and very. I mean, if you're on a road and your car breaks down and you use your mobile, you call your father and mother or children or a friend or whatever. How can we live without it?
I'll show you something here. It's very interesting. It was a research done in the University of Punjab in India, with mobile phones and bees. You know, bees are vanishing, and that's very dangerous for us. And they put into the beehives a mobile phone that wasn't working. And they were checking after 3 months. And then they put one where it was working for 15 minutes or something. It would be like two telephone calls a day. And after 3 months, they looked at all these. So there was total chaos in the cubes where the mobile phone had been. They had no honey. They were just crazy. The whole beehive was crazy. And when the mobile was there and it was not on, that was okay, and the control group was okay. So there's a lot.
So people should really be concerned about how much they're using their mobiles.
Exactly. And here it says, there was another one involved 13 countries, so-called interphone. 2010, a study, and it said that there is a higher risk of brain tumors for those who talk at least half an hour a day in 10 years. It was, you know, it's a 10-year study. And they said the normal use would be only one phone call a week in 6 months. Now, those who have mobiles, they call much more than one.
Much more than that, yeah.
So they're
all
at risk. And what do you do when you have a brain tumor then? It's too bad. You get Alzheimer's. There are in Oslo now, there are about 100 who are around 30 or under who have Alzheimer's. Senility.
At an early age, sure.
Yeah, because they talk. There's no other explanation. They talk.
But what if
you
use a headset? You know, like earplugs, earphones.
That's a good question, because somebody said that when you put it right in, it gets even worse.
Oh, but, lovely.
But remember, the industry will always present things upside down.
At least you don't get the beams next to your head.
But at least children are not allowed to use them. It should be that 80-year-old children should never use them. And it varies. Some countries say 16 or 18, because our brain system and our nervous system is not developed until we are adults. So the children are much, and youth is much, much more vulnerable. And then comes this Finnish physics professor and says, you know, there's not one study. I think it is immoral. Or if they are really so ignorant, which could be, then that's shame. I was at a MEMS conference once in Germany, and I think I was the only doctor. I mean, there are hundreds of physicists and students from technical universities, and they were just, you know, technology was number one. How do you put the circuits and whatever? I understood half of it, but not one talked about the dangers. And then in another conference in Ettlinger, which was a non-lethal weapons conference, and they put such a price, 900 euros to take part. You know, people don't have that much money for a conference, plus the hotel, plus the flight tickets, etc. So it's expensive. That way they keep only for the elite the knowledge. And it was clear there were people from factories who make these. I was sitting next to number two police chief of Germany. I mean, you know, it was that standard. There was an American colonel who 30, 50 years ago almost taught me how to bend spoons with your thoughts. I was shocked when I was able to do that in a 100th anniversary year of the Society for Psychical Research at the University of Cambridge. And he was already in Los Alamos doing research with mind control on these military things. Many times people say, who are they? You know, who is behind the scenes? Who is exactly steering all this? In the middle, that's the New World Order, the symbol. On this side, there's the Star of David. Star of David, who has Star of David? And on this side, there's CIA, FBI, and the British intelligence. They are them. New World Order was the name. But then, you know, the Star of David, of course, is very clear. And they do have, Israel is very, very powerful, and they have technology to attack Palestinians with this technology. Only Palestinians. In South Africa, Dr. Death was able to develop a system that only attacked the blacks. I mean, why do we, as human race, always make something negative? Why don't we make this system to make everybody a loving person, to heal everybody, and to have a good life for everybody? That could be done, but why don't we do it? That's up to everybody. And if we use our brain capacity en masse, we can change the mountains. I mean, really, you can change the mountains. And I think we should start doing it.
Through the power of thought.
Yeah. And when housewives say that, oh, what can I do, you know? I said, come on, you're doing dishes. When you're doing dishes, you can think. I'm sending love and light. I'm sending love and light. I'm sending love and light. I mean, that you can do.
But then people really have to become aware of how powerful thoughts are.
Exactly. But people don't, you know, they don't believe that they have the power. But they do. We are very powerful beings. We are beings of light. And like the Russian general said, interestingly, that a human being is a system of energy and information, and we can be influenced from outside, and that's why we can experience paranormal phenomena. This is official.
Briefly, to get back to the to vaccines, should people generally take vaccines today if they are prescribed by the doctors, for example?
Well, as a doctor, retired, but following up, I would say no, at least not in the Western
none
world.
None of the vaccines?
No, because you don't need them. See?
So should they turn to holistic medicine?
Well, that would help, because at least you can try, because with holistic medicine, with healing, there's absolutely medical, school medical research has shown that healing has an effect. Again, it's energy. Remember, we are energy inside a physical body. And when you give healing, it's not coming from you, it's coming through you, like you open the water faucet. You have to open it to get the water. And that, especially Russian research, is very good, because they had one that impressed me most was that a healer was holding his hands like this, and it started coming the energy through the fingers and through the hands, and they put a tennis ball in the middle. I mean, there was nothing here, but they put a tennis ball. He was able to hold it for 10 seconds. It was just there in the air because of the energy. And then it dropped, and he was sweating, and his heart was beating 130, you know, a minute, and then he also lost weight. So it's very strenuous. But think that it was absolutely proof that you can do something with energies. They have a lot. I have actually written an article about healing science fiction or the truth in my newest book, Bright Light on Black Shadows. It's so much hard information, but it's only facts and facts and facts. And when you know that, doctors don't want to read. They say, no, there's no. Because some are bored and some are ignorant. But all those doctors who go into the field, they're flabbergasted, and then they start, you know, doing with school medicine, giving healing. And that's, of course, the best combination.
Let's talk briefly about some of the most current topics of now, March 2013. The Vatican has a new pope, the old pope, Joseph Ratzinger, Pope Benedict the 16th. He resigned. That was the first time in, was it 600 or years?
400 or something, yeah.
Yeah, and now there's a new pope who just came in office, so to speak. What is your take on the on that
well, I read, issue? I read, I got email from International Tribune for against state and church criminality, and they were taking the old pope to court, because he was Cardinal Ratzinger for 25 years, and he was always saving all the priests and bishops who were dealing with pedophilia, with the choir boys and with the young priests, etc. He was protecting, which of course the Vatican has always done. There's a book called The Shame, Vatican's The Shame or something like that, and it lists hundreds of years of popes, what they have done sexually. I mean,
but they're not supposed to have sex when they take a vow of chastity.
They had sexual, you know, orgies. If you read that book, you know, and I took some parts of it into my new book from internet, you're shocked. Oh, they had sex with the prostitutes in Rome, and they got syphilis, and their feet were full of boils, so they could not, the people who kiss the Pope's feet at Easter, and we're just coming to Easter, they couldn't do it because he was full of boils. They had prostitutes, males and females, you know, entertaining. One Pope had sex with a mother and the daughter. One Pope had, and the names are all there listed, and the years when they were reigning. One Pope, it's so bad that I shouldn't be maybe say that, but one took from the street a 17-year-old boy who was with a monkey and could not read and write, but took him to his palace and made him into a cardinal. I mean, these are just facts. Why doesn't the
general
public know?
Yeah, but is it a fact?
Know? What?
Yeah, but is that really a fact?
Oh, yeah. In that it is a fact.
I'm sure that a lot of Catholics will disagree strongly with you.
Oh, they can disagree, but they have to find out facts. And they don't want to. And when something like that comes out, they say, no, this is not true. I don't believe, because it changes their worldview.
So do you think that's the reason that Pope Benedict resigned?
Yeah, because he was threatened.
It's the first time this happened in all those
exactly,
years.
Exactly, because Vatican got the letter, and he was the foreign minister of Vatican, a cardinal who got the letter, and they did not answer. But in 6 days, 6 days after they received the letter, all of a sudden the Pope resigned. Why? Because the foreign minister, what I read anyway, was that the cardinal had pushed him to resign because he didn't want to, because of to save the Vatican. But this International Tribune said that we are going to go against the next pope too, because it is the same. All the popes have always, through the years, been suppressing the information, especially what was happening. They were referring to Catholic schools in Canada, Indian schools, where the brothers, monks and priests, Catholic priests, were misusing the little children, girls and boys. And one adult Indian boy was going to be in the court case, number one witness. And he said, I read it, saw it on a video, he said that he will never ever forget the screams of a little girl when the priest was raping her and then killed her. And she was dumped with other children whom they killed into, you know, somewhere. And he was the main witness. What happened? All of a sudden, he got sick, got an injection, and died.
That does sound horrible.
That is so horrible. But now it's time that all these atrocities come out, because they
How much do you think that pedophilia is plays a part in the whole, well, within the elite circles, because within truth researching, a lot of people are talking about these pedophile cases. Yeah.
I think most of those today, what happened before, I don't know, but today, most of those elites who are using young boys and girls, they are microchipped. They are anyway mind controlled, because the cruelty towards the little kids is so bad that it is not human. It is not human.
Well, don't you just call it psychopaths? It does sound like that if you don't have empathy.
Course,
you
of
don't
course,
have to be microchipped.
Okay, I mean, was Hitler a psychopath? Was Stalin a psychopath? Why do we...
Well, did they have microchips at that time?
No. Oh yeah, sure. Already in 40s they had them. I have a list of
What about the psychopaths then? What's the? It seems like
they were not called microchip. They were called electrodes that they were pushing in the brain, and the first time they did that in Ohio, in Dayton, Ohio, at the Good Samaritan Hospital. Think of the name, Good Samaritan Hospital. They put electrodes into the brain of a female patient who afterwards died. In 1946, in Karolinska, in Sweden. Stockholm, they were putting, also in Saska Children's Hospital, they were putting, it was Dr. Alm, into the electrodes into the brain of a little boy, Bengt. And the mother, I've talked with the mother, and said that they destroyed him. He did live to be an adult, but he suffered all his life. Now, this is called medical research. And when you say that, you know, something terrible happens within medicine, it's called research. You can do anything. And now Diagnostic Statistical Manual for Mental Disorders has just come out, number 5, by the American Psychiatric Association. And there, it almost, I would say, every person can be put as psychotic or mentally ill or, you know, disturbed anyway, because that way you can take anybody who is in opposition of the government, you can take them in. And there is a diagnose opposition of the government, and that is mentally disturbed. I mean, come on.
But how do you explain young people, like, it's, you know, really, which is also a very current topic, with all the school shootings, especially what happened in December 2012 at Sandy Hook, with this young boy shooting all of these people in his school, and then himself and his mother. There's a terrible thing.
Well, as far as I have heard, that it is 3 shooters there. It probably was a false flag operation. It was law enforcement that said that it was 3 shooters. And his father, a businessman, was also working for CIA. Now there is a red alert again. And the pictures that went all over the world of, you know, little girls and boys, beautiful, smiling, none of them are dead. The school that CNN showed, that this is the Sandy Hook school, it was not Sandy Hook school.
So but how can they cover that up, even in the media?
Everything comes out now, but mass media, CNN shows, so majority thinks that is Sandy Hook school. But then somebody realized it wasn't. Things come out. And
how can we prove that? People could go to the school, couldn't they, and see how it looks?
That's right. But the same morning, I think it was, they always, when they do a false flag operation, they have an exercise before, like in Utøya and Oslo, tragedy 22nd of July, a year ago, there was an exercise of 22 Delta Group police, how a lonesome man kills everybody on an island and how they react. In Sandy Hook, 40 miles away, there was an exercise in another school, how, you know, they react when the school shooter comes in. That already is, hey, red alert again.
But if you call this a false flag operation as well, why did that have to happen, school shootings?
Oh, that's, children are vulnerable and people think it's awful to kill children, right? If it was all adults, it would be different, but children are precious.
Probably bad as well.
Yeah. But why? To get change in the gun laws so that everybody they can take guns away, and that is in the ground law of the United States, that you can, I think it was Second Amendment, that you are allowed to carry a gun.
And but America also has the highest rate of all of shooters. I mean, people who shoot because they have guns, because they're allowed to have guns. Isn't it good that they take the guns away?
No, because when they take all the guns away, then they cannot defend themselves. They cannot. I was flabbergasted.
And defend themselves against who?
The government. Because it's quite clear that they are planning something in the United States now. I mean, when you follow these things, it's, you know, there are warning signs, and the warning signs, red alert, is coming. And if they take the guns away, you cannot defend yourself. But 200 sheriffs have already said that they are not going to go with this. They are not going to take guns away. Now, if sheriffs say no, even 200, maybe some more, there can be a clash between. And as I read, officers have been asked, are they willing to kill their own? This is Americans. And those officers who say no, well, all of a sudden they don't become generals or whatever. So there is a planning going on all the time, all the time. And to my great surprise, I'm on the surprise, on the mailing list of the White House, because I signed a petition that White House should inform, and they needed 5,000 signatures, about our cosmic contacts and be truthful. They changed. They said, we have no proof of any extraterrestrial things. So Stephen Bassett, who is the leader for an organization, Paradigm Research Group, wrote again, but then, you know, with proof, humanoid autopsies and whatever, pictures, military reports, because of the Freedom of Information Act. So there's proof. What happened? White House raised and said, we need 25,000 signatures before they answer. And now it's 100,000 signatures. So clearly they don't want to have the truth out.
So when you give this information now to a lot of people, in your lectures, you travel around the world, you write books, you write articles and talk about it everywhere, mm-hmm. people will probably become a little bit paranoid, I mean, and afraid and fearful of all of these horrible things if the world really is like this. What would you suggest people should do? There will be really an uprising. I mean, if people
will
think this is the truth.
I hope there will be an uprising, because number one is awareness. They have to know. I mean, they have children and grandchildren. They don't want children and grandchildren to grow up in a world which is the reality today, which they have not known, because it's
But under, how about under the wraps. Fear factor? People will be very fearful hearing this information from
you. Well, number one, there's no death. Number two, don't care what others say. Number three, remember you are a being of light. You have the power, which is incredible. I mean, why do, especially Russian research, you know, they can concentrate on something, and, you know, I want that thing to move, and the things start moving. They have Nina Kulagina has stopped the computers and the electrical appliances and everything. So that is only with the power of your thought. And when we could, you know, take spoons and forks and just bend them like it would be, you know, soft.
But most people can't do that.
Oh, everybody can do that. I arranged in the Parapsychological Association of Lapland, which I founded after I had been to Cambridge, where we were doing it. So, you know, I said, take spoons, and now we'll do it. And somebody, it was Colonel John Alexander, who said that, for some reason, 25 people is an optimal, that's a good energy. So I said, 25 people, and we started. And, you know, they were flabbergasted, because 20 could bend the spoons. And they were just normal people. Interesting was that two children, they were, it was in a second, because they did not know, the children, that it's impossible. You know, they thought, okay, Rami says that, you know, bend it with your thoughts, so. But one was interesting finding that a woman who was you know, pregnant, she couldn't do it. The baby needed it. So we can do anything with our thoughts. And awareness, 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 and then start thinking positively, positively, positively. That the world will change. And people do not think if they don't know. And it's absolutely not to be fearful, because that's what the elite wants. That's how they manipulate mankind, because of fear.
So no fear?
Absolutely no fear.
Consciousness, awareness?
Yeah.
Well,
that's and our send love and light.
Love and light.
Especially well, those who are in the elite, because they need it most.
Well, as the our first documentary, Age of Truth film, was called The Grande Dame of Consciousness. Once again, Dr. Rauni Kilde, you've proven that it's quite mind-blowing to have this conversation with you, and we thank you very much for talking to us.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Age of Truth.